Oh, sorry about that. Greetings, my fellow from the Southern Thinkers. This is L3's News Podcast. My name is Craig, transmitting from the beautiful swampy Mango, South Florida. And today's date is Thursday, June 14th, 2018. It is Flag Day. I'll be talking about that during this episode. However, I'm at Stash, located at 109 Southwest 2nd Avenue in the heart of the Hemisphere District of Fort Lauderdale, adjacent with Revolution Live and America's Backyard. So everyone be still talking about mainly what happened with the peace agreement along with President Trump and Kim Jong-un. Denuclearization, excuse me, and no military drills along the North Korean area. And some folks said, like the Stratford Networks, I call it, you know, like to thank Sean Adams for that. The Stratford Network, such as New York Times, was Trump was outfoxed by Kim Jong-un, and some of the people were mucking all these complainants, and all these war hawks may be finding offensive. And, of course, there's video from the John Birch Society talked about how the New World Order is very upset with President Trump. So it's very interesting because I've been real critical about this whole thing a while back on North Korea and so forth. And don't get me wrong, I've never been a supporter of Kim Jong-un or any form of government. However, you have to always got to look at the history and how all this, the origins and how this occurred. That's why I recommend people read the book Blowback by Chalmers Johansson. There was a chapter in there in reference to Korea and how the CIA blundered that one up. And then everything fell into place with the 30th parallel, the Korean conflict, the illegal war. And in addition, had like one third of the population of North Korea was wiped off the map. And after the truce, they were left there for rubble. So it's been a big grudge towards the United States, Britain, and many others that were involved in this illegal war with North Korea. And some of a lot of folks are saying that you got outfoxed, China's going to be using the United States and all that good stuff. And even too, there's one video link that was done by Dan Dix of Press for Truth talking about the mineral that North Korea ascertains, a natural mineral that was used for high-tech gadgets such as smartphones, cell phones, and all that good stuff. So you have to like always look at things a lot broader than what it is. And that's how I see it as well. But I'm going to be talking about that as the first thing on the platform. But definitely check out like those videos like Press for Truth and on that Mineral Wars, which is very interesting. You always got to say Keo Bono, who benefits. And, of course, they said Donald Trump may be eligible for the Nobel Peace Prize. Of course, there'd be controversies that, well, because remember President Barack Obama got the same thing that him and NATO attacked Libya to overthrow Muammar Gaddafi, and they still want to use that claim that, oh yeah, it was for what happened in around Scotland when the plane got blown open, when the plane got exploded. It was supposed to be on the hands of him. However, when you really look at the bigger picture, he stopped playing ball with the banksters by creating his own version of the African Union using gold. The coins for Libya was backed up by commodity, gold. And the World Bank, the IMF, did not like that at all. That's just my personal memorable viewpoint. Because if you study history, it happens everywhere you go. Including the famous presidents got shot. Okay, like John F. Kennedy, Garfield, McKinley. Okay, a couple others, including they tried to assassinate Andrew Jackson, but it failed. Even Abraham Lincoln, which I was very critical of him, a lot of his actions as president. But when the United States start using greenbacks instead of getting the loan from the U.S. bank, central bank, that added 35% interest to pay back the loan. And that's when the cabinet says, Mr. President, we have Congress can regulate money, so he used that as well. So some people may believe that Kim Jong-un may be taken out after this, but someone made a valid point. If we stop playing ball with the banksters or drop the petrodollar, then it could be a backlash based on past practices. So I'll say all in good faith, and pretty quiet here. Here's some music in the background, which is all well and good. I dig it here. It has some character. Alright, speaking of that, of the peace treaty, which may have to be approved by the Senate according to Article 6, because it's supposed to be a peace agreement, it's considered a treaty. So we'll see if it will follow through. But it says here, this is by Brandon Turbeville. It's off of Activist Post, and I found this originally on Land Destroyer, which is landdestroyer.com or landdestroyer.blogspot.com. And that's a real good, very, I would say, anti-imperialistic viewpoints from the New Eastern Outlook. So you should guys check it out as well. Good stuff. Always got to look at everything across the board, not what the propaganda machine is trying to teach you. Like I always tell my listeners, always observe responsibly. So, it says here, is Trump-Kim deal really peace, or is it a setup for war? That's the question by Brandon Turbeville, once again. It's here, Presidents Donald Trump and Kim Jong-un are perhaps the two most unpredictable leaders in the world, with everyone wondering from day to day what new provocative statement will be ushered from official channels. However, the most unpredictable leaders appear to found common ground, perhaps even kindred spirit, during the course of the Singapore summit, with both men came away with an apparent mutually beneficial deal that we see at the escalations of tensions of the Korean Peninsula. While there's having no real concrete agreements as a result of the talks, the North Korean side has pledged its commitment to the denuclearization of the peninsula, while the American side has strongly suggested that it will put its military exercise on hold with South Korea. And to be very frank, the United States shouldn't really be near the wars of other foreign countries without their consent. So in that aspect, if you just patrol in that area, it's considered to imagine if China or North Korea goes near our coastlines, like 12 miles, a little over 12 miles off our coastlines. Are you going to be celebrating? I don't think so. The first step seems to be an agreement for both sides who work toward recovering the remains of the Korean War dead and their immediate repatriation, excuse me. beyond that, the statement agreed by both parties as follows. President Donald J. Trump of the United States of America and Chairman Kim Jong-un of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, which is DPRK, held first historic summit in Singapore on June 12, 2018. President Trump and Chairman Kim Jong-un conducted a comprehensive, in-depth, and sincere exchange of opinions on the issues related to the establishment of the new U.S.-DPRK relations and the building of a lasting and robust peace regime on the Korean Peninsula. President Trump committed to providing security guarantees to the DPRK, and the Chairman Kim Jong-un reaffirmed his unwavering commitment to complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Convinced that the establishment of the new U.S.-DPRK relations will contribute to the peace and prosperity of the Korean Peninsula and of the world, and recognizing that mutual confidence building can promote the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, President Trump and Chairman Kim Jong-un, the state following, the United States and the DPRK commitment to establish the new U.S.-DPRK relations in accordance with the desire of the peoples of the two countries for peace and prosperity. The United States and DPRK will join their efforts to build a lasting, stable peace regime on the Korean Peninsula, reaffirmed the April 27, 2018 Panmunjom Declaration, the DPRK commits to work toward complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. The United States and the DPRK commit to recovering POW MIA remains, including immediate repatriation of those already identified. Having acknowledged that the U.S. DPRK summit, the first in history, was an ethical event of great significance in overcoming decades of tension and hostilities between the two countries and for the opening up of a new future. President Trump and Chairman Kim Jong-un commit to implementing the stipulations in the joint statement for fully and expeditiously. The United States and DPRK commit to holding follow-on negotiations led by the U.S. Secretary of State Mark Pompeo, which he was a CIA director at one time, and the relevant high-level DPRK official at the earliest possible date to implement the outcomes of the U.S.-DPRK summit. After President Donald Trump of the United States of America and Chairman Kim Jong-un of the State Affairs Commission of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, I commit to cooperate for the development of the new U.S.-DPRK relations and to promote the peace and prosperity and security of the Korean Peninsula and of the world. And of course, Donald J. Trump, President of the United States, he had a signature, and Kim Jong-un, Chairman of the State Affairs Commission of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, June 12th, Sentosa Island, Singapore. The talks have concluded, but the reminder of the negotiation to take place between Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, and his counterpart, with some suggesting that the next stage is the freeing of American spies incarcerated in North Korea. Reactions from American political circles, while Republicans have never met a war they didn't like, attempting to keep their rage at the idea of peace under control. Man like Chicken Hawk Lindsey Graham appeared on national media to tone down praise of Trump and warned of showing weakness and removing troops from one of America's many war zones. And there's a train coming by. One moment here. Okay, cool. sorry about that. Essentially, they are arguing that America should dictate the terms. Kim should agree, and there should be no American concession of any value. So he's saying you gotta watch out for them, and this and that. We all know Lindsey Graham too is a warmongering chicken hawk. Anyway, because he can make money for the military-industrial complex. That's his goal anyway. We should throw his ass in the front line. Let's see how tough this clown is, and of his lackeys as well. Imagine some of these glam boys in there running in the front line and have a mirror in front of them. They can look pretty in combat. Especially Lindsey Graham, but he's so damn ugly. He can't even the most decrepit individuals in the world would be turned off by him. So I wouldn't even recommend him to my worst enemies, right? Democrats, however, have predictably been frothing at the mouth at even the idea of peace, particularly at peace negotiated by literally Hitler himself, Donald Trump. These warmongers and psychotics have rallied against even talking to Kim Jong-un, claiming that there should be no peace whatsoever with the nation. That has such a horrible human rights violation, and as if the United States has not racked up enough the same violations of its own. This creates complaint that Trump is engaging in appeasement of some kind, which seems impossible to explain to anyone using logic who is restrained by reality. But what is actually happening with the summit? Is it true a genuine desire for peace, or is it just cover for the next war to take shape over the next several years? That's a legitimate question. But the potential positive is difficult for any genuine anti-war activist to impose in recent talks between the United States and North Korea. After decades of technical war direct to obliterate North Korea, constant nuclear tests, repeatedly provocative war games, innumerable threats against one another, not to mention the tension between South and North Korea, two countries that have long way to talk to one another, the fact that tensions seem to be easing can scarcely be considered a bad thing. while it is unfair that the United States and its allies can maintain nuclear weapon stockpiles as they march across the globe slaughtering innocent people while other countries cannot. The end to nuclear proliferation across the board is also desirable. If both countries can come to an agreement to, at the very least, stop provoking one another, America have taken the greatest step toward peace in Singapore than it has in decades. For all that their public appearances, both Trump and Kim have appeared legitimately happy as a result of the meeting, and both have expressed high hopes for the future. Trump even went so far as to tweet that the nuclear threat of North Korea no longer existed. But there is more to deal than just desire for peace. Despite America's desire for war, or at least the appearance of potential war, both Koreas have expressed a desire not to only talk, but to unify. A historic meeting in April 2018, the presidents of North South Korea met and agreed to remove nuclear weapons from the Korean Peninsula and begin negotiating an end to the Korean War. Despite the influence of the United States on South Korea and the human rights nightmare in North Korea, it remains unclear that both Koreas have interest in ending the war, bringing about peace and perhaps moving forward with integration. And I can say this, a lot of the folks in that peninsula want this to happen and in good faith, because believe it or not, there's families, okay, that lived across that, between the right along that parallel, haven't seen each other for half a century, and that is horrible. So people, a lot of folks are pro-family, they should be concerned with this issue. And even a person like myself have to always say it's up to the people in Korea if they want true peace, security, prosperity with the peninsula across the nation from both ends of the parallel, 38th parallel. And I'm pretty damn convinced that the folks, the rank and file, we call them, okay, want this to be a reality, a fact, honorably, truly official. And I'll continue on here. Was the deal mutual, or was it negotiate a position of strength and weakness? Well, it may publicly appear that the recent US-NK peace deal was a mutual desire between both parties to de-escalate and move towards peace. Some analysts question whether or not that is the case and posit that the deal may have actually been made as a strategy of last resort on the part of the North Koreans. As Andrew Curry Miracle writes for the Eurasian Future in his article, the Trump-Kim deal is the first example of the new Washington consensus. As it currently stands, China has monopolized a large chunk of its neighbor's economy, not out of any malicious or neo-imperialism intention, but simply because it has been the only lifeline to the Hermit Kingdom. Since the Soviet Union collapsed and Moscow cut off all of its previous aid to the country, for all practical intents and purposes, China controls the North Korean economy, an open secret that, known to even the most casual observer, even if politically incorrect, the public say is regularly denied by Beijing. The never-ending international sanctions had effect of scaring off most of the other investors, and Russia entered the game way too late in the possible past couple of years to make any tangible differences. Moreover, by the time that Moscow got interested in North Korea's economic potential as a transit state connecting the investment-hungry but energy-rich Far East region with cash flushed by but energy for South Korea, international sanctions became tighter, and Russia itself also signed onto them together with China. The cumulative effect of this latest development, particularly in terms of China's honest participation in the latest round of sanctions, for reasons related to its unease at having nuclear-armed neighbor play useful idiot in bringing American anti-missile infrastructure closer to its borders, was that North Korea had a little choice other than to negotiate with the U.S. and consider its nuclear capabilities. Faced with the real fear of experiencing another nationwide famine, such as the one that reportedly struck in the country in the 1990s, Chairman Kim's immediate interests were purely economic, and he painfully came to perceive of his big brother, and the North as a great power who isn't above playing political games in the pursuit of the self-interest. And China's defense, its global strategy of multi-plurality, was being endangered by what is considered to be Kim's recklessness in engaging in so many nuclear tests. But regardless of the bounds of trust were irrevocably broken between these two. That, however, that doesn't mean that North Korea regards China as an enemy, but just that the young Kim had a rude awakening in terms of how the real world works. In the first hand, that slogans ideological solidarity about a shared communist struggle don't compensate for his country's disadvantageous position as a pawn of the hyper-realist, the 19th century great power chessboard. Disheartening by his realization and likely feeling some natural resentment towards his former benefactors, Kim decided to enter into unpleasant nuclearization talks with the U.S. through prudently taking care of involved China in all matters of his consultations, as to not to inadvertently make an enemy out of it, given how easily this very sensitive situation could have returned into a fast-moving security dilemma between Pyongyang and Beijing. He had not had the wisdom to do so, seeking sanctions and relief and counterbalance to China, Kim ultimately agreed to the Singapore summit with Trump. Having predictably have been brief on the psychological economic factors that drove Kim to come to the Singapore summit and in all likelihood agree beforehand on what outcome of this historic event would be, Trump came to the event with the fullest of confidence, but also with the secret ace up his sleeve to sweeten the deal that he was about to publicly clinch with his counterpart. It has now been revealed that Trump showed Kim a Hollywood-style 4-minute video extolling the economic and developmental benefits that North Korea could receive if its chairman chooses the right path at this once-in-a-lifetime crossroads that the film dramatically hints he was fated to appear at. Evidently, Kim must have really enjoyed the promise of the message that was convened, because all of his body language immediately after his private viewing of his film with Trump during a one-on-one meeting was exceptionally positive and radiated happiness, sincerity, and confidence. He has agreed to advance his country's denuclearization. In an interview with the Tasmanian news agency, Cory Boker also stands that after all, North Korea already blew up its only nuclear testing site, and its leader raced to win back Trump's approval for the Singapore summit instead of the reverse. That implies that the U.S. is negotiating from a position of strength while North Korea is doing so from weakness, showing which two wants denuclearization of happening before. The lesson of both parties learned that this their's highest representatives need to watch their words in order not to provoke either side to responding with any dramatic as means of saving their reputations, thereby potentially endangering the forthcoming talks and complicating North Korea's strategic surrender to U.S. exchange for the promised aid and investment. Something we'll really look at, right? So the question whether or not the North Korean side felt they had no other option than to move forward with a nuclear political deal, not much like the Iran deal, in order to save face and survive. After all, it is not reasonable to require North Korea to disarm from its only real deterrent, while its enemy, who has been breathing down its neck for the last several decades, simply promised not to attack it. A more important question, however, is whether or not the United States is negotiating in good faith, or whether the new deal is another Iran deal to feign an effort for peace while preparing for and even initiating war. So it's always like you gotta look at all sides. That's why you always have to be observant, responsive, observe responsibly, and be vigilant. And even if this happens, Lord forbid, expect it to be under his successor's regime, not just the Trump administration itself, but possibly the successor. So we gotta look at that as well. The Libya model, given that the United States has done nothing for its foreign policy but conduct illegal imperialist wars against sovereign countries that provided no threat to now for decades. concept that the United States is negotiating good faith is hard to believe. It's particularly hard to believe when the United States had only recently engaged in epic harassment, politically, diplomatically, and militarily against North Korea. Even more so when the National Security Advisor repeated war criminal John Bolton stated plainly to Fox News Sunday that we have very much in mind the Libyan model from 2003 to 2004. Libya negotiated in good faith with the Bush administration to eliminate its nuclear weapons. 7 years later, the country found itself on the wrong end of the U.S.-backed stabilization effort, which soon became a proxy war and quickly became a NATO invasion. The result, the Libya was left in absolute shambles, where it remains to this day. Race slavery was instituted by some of the many Islamic fundamentalist militias supported by the United States to overthrow Gaddafi, who was himself sodomized by a bayonet and executed on camera. Bolton elaborated further on the Libya motto reference on CBS Face the Nation, where he stated, in case of Libya, for example, and it's a different situation in some respects, those negotiations were carried out in private. They were not only publicly, but the one thing that Libya did that led us to overcome our skepticism was that they allow American and British observers into all their nuclear-related sites, so it wasn't a question of relying on international mechanisms. We saw them in ways we have never seen before. Notably, the North Korea talks are taking place in public, even if they aren't being met with high praise. Interestingly enough, Kim Jong-un seems to have a clear understanding of why it's giving up one nuclear weapon is a bad idea. Particularly when it comes to the United States. In 2011, Libya sunk under the wave of chaos. Kim stated that Gaddafi's decision to give up his nuclear weapons was a mistake. A North Korean foreign ministry official also described the denuclearization process as an invasion tactic that disarmed the country. The official also stated that the Libyan model touted by Bolton was a proof that North Korea's strategy was the right one and that nuclear weapons was the only way to keep peace on the peninsula. Surely Kim Jong-un has not forgotten his own wisdom in terms of dealing with the United States. After all, there's a little difference between dealing with Bush, Obama, or Trump administration. On the other hand, every seasoned leader like Gaddafi fell prey to deception and false promises of the U.S. For this reason, it cannot be ignored that one possibly as to why the United States seems so interested in peace at this point is related to removing Kim's nuclear deterrent. So you gotta always look at these patterns and past practices, and so you have to always examine those areas too. And what the Mr. Tuberville is addressing: past history. The past is today's greatest teacher. No ends, ifs, or buts. And so the question is: will Kim Jong Un drop the petrodollar and do his old gold standards and so forth? So that could be possibly too. If that's the case, then they find a way to overthrow it, and they'll use all the whole old repertoire of torturing people and all that. Like with Gaddafi, with the blowing up of Scotland, okay, the airplane over Scotland, blaming it on him. Oh, that's where we invaded them. Please, stop lying to the American people, you bunch of straffling pieces of garbage. That's how I look at the lamestream press, lamestream media. Like all this people, they bend over and they get respect. There's no merit along a lot of their views. I know I'm ranting here, so sorry about that. Okay, the Iran deal president. On Tuesday, May 8th, U.S. President Donald Trump announced that the United States will be pulling out of the Iran nuclear deal, which was struck by under the Obama administration, a deal that would apparently call a bad deal and even the single worst deal I ever seen drawn by anybody. The so-called Iran deal was supposed to protect the United States and our allies from the lunacy of the Iran nuclear bomb, a weapon that will only a dangerous survival of the Iranian regime, President Trump said. In fact, the deal allowed Iran to continue enriching uranium over time, and over time reach the nuclear breakout. He added that today we have definite proof that the Iranian promise was a lie, yet there was absolutely no evidence to back up Trump on his claims. Even Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, the Director of National Intelligence Daniel Coates, has stated that Iran is living up to its commitments. Still, Trump has argued in the past that while Iran may be sticking to its commitments, it is violating the spirit of the agreement by fostering discord in the region. Well, it's all lip service, post facto hearsay fact, and I'm gonna be surprised if the Israeli government's trying to pick their brain. You gotta see this, or else they'd be anti-Semitic. So I will continue on here. This is highly ironically considering that the United States is the single biggest foster of discord in the Middle East, along Israel. It's also false that Iran is fostering discord, and that is not living up to its end of the deal. It should be pointed out that Iran was doing wrong in terms of its nuclear program before the deal, and should never have been bullied into signing it to begin with. Now, a sovereign country has a right to pursue a nuclear energy program is being told by aggressive nuclear states that it cannot be allowed to be armed in the same manner, develop an adequate energy program, or defend itself against the aggression of the very states marching across the region and repeatedly stating their desire to overthrow the state or invade Iran. So the thing is a thing called exceptionalism. You can't do it, but we can. But this, while this move may have come as a shock to some, it shouldn't have. After all, the Iran deal itself was nothing more than the first step in the coming war on Iran. This can be seen clearly in the pages of the corporate finance think tanks who develop and the present U.S. foreign and domestic policy. For instance, the Brookings Institution, as John Curley writes, whose corporate finance responses include arms manufacturers Boeing, Lockheed Martin, and Raytheon, energy giants ExxonMobil, BP, Armco, and Chevron, and the financiers, including Bank of America, Citi, and numerous advisors and trustees provided by Goldman Sachs, wrote 2009 to use such a deal than to justify military actions against Iran. It's a little book here called Which Path to Persia? The Brookings Report, Institution Report, Which Path to Persia? The plan for a Western Israeli attack on Iran alongside with the theater of the alleged U.S.-Israeli tensions leading up to a strike and outright war had been in the works for some time. For instance, in the 2009 Brookings Institution, a major banking, corporate, and military industrial firm released a report entitled Which Path to Persia? Options for a New American Strategy for Iran, in which authors mapped out plans which leaves no doubt as the ultimate desire from the Western financial, corporate, and governing class. Here's a link for that, too. You should see it for yourselves. And it's all right in their PDF format. I'm about to send this to some of my friends. At least you can know what's happening. The plan involved the description of a number of ways the Western oligarchy would be able to destroy Iran, including outright military invasion and occupation. However, the report attempts to outline a number of methods that might possibly be implemented before the direct military invasion would be necessary. The plan included an attempt to foment destabilization inside Iran, a via colored revolution, apparatus, violent arrest, proxy terrorism, and limited airstrikes conducted by the U.S., Israel, or both. Interestingly enough, the report states that any action taken against Iran must be done after the idea that Iran has rejected a fair and generous offer by the West has been decimated throughout the general public. The report reads, any military operation against Iran will likely be very unpopular around the world and require to proper international context, both to ensure the logistical support of the operation would require and to minimize the blowback from it. The best way to minimize international opprobrium and maximize support, however, Gotti will convert, is to strike only when there is a widespread conviction that the Iranians were given, but then rejected a superb offer. One so good that only a regime determined to acquire nuclear weapons and acquire them for the wrong reason would turn it down. Under those circumstances, the United States or Israel could portray its operations and has taken in sorrow, not anger, and at least some of the international community will conclude that the Iranians brought on themselves by refusing a very good deal. So we could probably say, what's going on with the so-called top possible regime change in Iran could be a Ajax 2.0, allegedly. That could be very sincere. Like, when I hear about these regime changes, it has to be organic, nothing else. I'll proceed here. From the writings of Brookings, it is repeatedly apparent for all to see what the latest browbeating over that terrible Iran deal and how Iranians are not living up to the obligations under the agreement coming from the Trump administration are all about. The United States has bullied Iran into accepting the deal and should never have to had to agree in the first place. And now the U.S. is attempting to add restrictions and obligations that were never part of the deal to begin with, and or claim that Iran is not living up to its end of the deal. If Iran can be represented as having been uncooperative, Iran will be painted as refused a very good deal. And of course, that's one of those things you gotta look at, right? I don't know, I see all these folks now. Yes, yeah, so there's a little sound check in here. Hopefully it doesn't interfere. Let me check this out. Yeah, it's not too bad. All right. Good. So it's not too horrible. Oh, good. Came out pretty good. So we'll continue on here. As the report states, any action against Iran must be done after the idea that Iran has rejected a fair and generous offer by the West. The West has decimated throughout the general public. For that, the reason the idea is being promulgated that Iran was offered a great deal at the advantage of the United States, but Iran will not be abide by even this agreement, continuing to insist for gaining nuclear weapons to destroy the U.S. and pour it into Israel, forcing America's hand after the diplomacy failed. Ironically, it is admitted by the authors of the report that the Iranians were not given by lunatics intent on nuking the world but by entirely rational players. Still, they move forward, but the number of options for attacking Iran, it should thus be obvious to anyone reading this report that the U.S., NATO, and Israel are uninterested in peace with Iran, nor entirely focused on war and Iranian destruction. Yes, New World Order at its best. Can we say that? So everyone put their hands and then put your right hand to over your heart and saying, I will support the New World Order imperialism. If not, I am a traitor. Amen. The so-called Iran deal introduced during the administration of U.S. President Barack Obama represents precisely this superb offer, with Flynn's accusation serving as a turn down ahead of the Tsar War and attempted regime change. The U.S. has always planned to target Tehran with right. Tony Carlucci of the Land Destroyer report. The report discussed the citation that could be used for an attack in Iran, clearly stating its intentions to create a plan to go to a non-threatening nation into war, it states. The truth in this case would be challenging case, the truth that these all would be challenging cases to make. For that reason, it would be far more preferable if the United States could cite an Iranian provocation as justification for the airstrikes before launching them. I will proceed. The report continues to discuss the citations that could be used for attacking Iran, clearly stating intentions to create a plan to guard non-threatening nation into war. It states the truth that all these would be challenging cases to make. For that reason, it would be far more preferable if the United States could cite an Iranian provocation as justification for airstrikes before launching them. Clearly, the more outrageous, the more deadly, and the more unprovoked the Iranian action, the better off the United States would be. Of course, it will be very difficult for the United States to goad Iran into such provocation without the rest of the world recognizing this game, which would then undermine it. One method that would have some possibility of success would be to ratchet up covert regime change efforts in the hope that Tehran would retaliate overtly or even semi-overtly, which could then be portrayed as an unprovoked act of Iranian aggression. So, they're saying the same thing about covert regime change. Can we say Operation Ajax 2.0? Little history lesson there, my friend. So, you should always check those out. Conclusion, while the steps toward peace should be lauded, we must ensure these steps are actually being taken toward peace and not to another Libya model. North Korea may want to re-enter the world at large, but it must not do so if the end result will be the destruction of the country yet again. So Kim Jong-un already has nuclear weapons and the ability to deliver them. He has significant bargaining power in any negotiation. Upon given those weapons, however, he will have placed North Korea in a precarious position. It may be too early to tell of yet what will be the result of the Trump-Kim agreement. But for now, those who truly desire for peace must keep a watchful and skeptical eye open. And I have to agree, it's why vigilance is relevant. Based on past practices, coup attempts and so forth, imperialism's past history. And a lot of folks, dude, like I said before, the people in that peninsula, the beautiful Korean people from both sides, want this to be a reality, a fact. They're tired of this conflict with one another on a political perspective. And even some of my past episodes, I did talk about how North and South Korea are trying to talk to one another, but oh, we can't do that. What, you're going to tell countries how to wipe our butts? I'm tired of that too. I'm tired of seeing my tax dollars, okay, telling other countries how to think and vice versa. You read, like I said before, read the stuff what John Jay has to say. Federalist Papers 2-5. Okay, so enough of this bickering, left-right paradigm, propaganda, all from the same one-dimensional platforms. Look at the bigger picture. So, and it was interesting too, because I'm gonna add something here. It's pretty interesting too. What John Rapoport said, it's showtime in North Korea, and he talked about possible beaches and businesses, maybe enhance North Korea and restructure it so they can benefit. And that could be possible as well. So yeah, you can folks can read that and make your own judgment. And it's a pretty good synopsis what Mr. Rapoport has to say about crony capitalism rise again, and it would be in North Korea. So we can look at examine that as well. And so I'm gonna have to narrate it, but read it yourselves. Very interesting viewpoint. I came out yesterday, by the way, and we can look at Article 6. Paragraph 2 says, this Constitution, the laws of the United States, which shall be made in pursuance thereof, and all treaties are made, or which shall be made under the authority of the United States, shall be the supreme law of the land, and the judges in every various states shall be bound thereby, anything constitutional law, and contrary notwithstanding. Of course, third paragraph, the Senate of Representatives are before mentioned, the members of the state legislators, and all executive judicial officers, both of the United States and the several states, shall be bound by oath or of affirmation. So another thing too, we have to find out, it's got to be approved, okay, to make this official. And that's why even with the Iran nuclear deal, I tell people, you guys, read it before you jump to conclusions. But one thing about it in the article is that all he signed it was okay for the Senate to review it. No, it has to be approved by the Senate before everything becomes official. Not the other way around. And like even with this peace deal, it could be considered unconstitutional as well. In hindsight, so I recommend the Senate in there, if to support any new peace deals with North Korea, make it a reality. All right. So I'll be right back. All right. So next one we'll be checking out is very interesting. It happened in Minnesota. Came out today by the Rutherford Institute. Free speech victory. U.S. Supreme Court strikes down Minnesota law banning political expression on clothing wear at polling places. And in Washington, D.C., in a decisive 7-2 ruling in favor of the First Amendment's guarantee of freedom of speech, the United States Supreme Court has struck down an unconstitutionally vague Minnesota law that bans political speech on any badge, button, shirt, hat worn at an election polling station. In weigh-in of the Minnesota Voters Alliance versus Joe Mansky, attorney for the Rutherford Institute, Cato Institute, the Reason Foundation, and the Individual Rights Foundation, had argued that the Minnesota law opens to an abuse voters' free speech rights by giving appointing election officials unlimited discretion to need to remember what political speech should be censored, and as a sweeping prohibition for the First Amendment speech. For example, the Minnesota law could have interpreted in such a way was to classify as political and prohibit popular but I voted contextless images such as a marijuana leaf and even iconic photographs of Gandhi, Martin Luther King, or John Lennon. The polling site is one of the few remaining places where citizens can effectively voice their discontent with their government, said constitutional attorney John W. Whitehead, president of the Rutherford Institute and author of Battlefield America, The War on the American People. Shutting down this traditional forum of expression threatens the very democratic principles in this nation was founded on and undermines, excuse me here, got a little distracted, undermines the purpose of the First Amendment. Thankfully, the court's acknowledgement that the Minnesota clothing ban statute is a violation of fundamental right of freedom of speech will preserve the integrity of the First Amendment and the polling place. In 2010, legislators in Minnesota revised its election laws, including the ban wearing any apparel, and include political speech at polling places of Minnesota Statute 211B.11 grants unelected and unaccountable polling judges the power to prevent voters from wearing any political badges, political buttons, or other political insignia, or at or about the police place on primary or election day. On election day, several registered voters were specifically threatened with prosecution or were told to remove clothing items and buttons that read, "Please ID me," or had Tea Party logos. An untold number of other voters were deterred from wearing such items in the first place on the threat of prosecution. The following the election, the district court dismissed the lawsuit, meant the statute was not unconstitutional on its face. The voters' rights group appealed to the U.S. Court of Appeals of the 8th Circuit, which affirmed part of the decision but returned to the case of the district court to decide if the law was valid as applied to some speech. After district court and court of appeals ruled that the law was valid, the voters' rights group filed a petition in June 2017 asking the Supreme Court to review the law and weigh in on the case in support of the voters' rights group. Rutherford Institute and the coalition partner argued that the law constitutes an overbroad ban on political speech and is not justified by compelling state interest, thereby undermining the fundamental guarantee of the First Amendment's free speech clause. And there's a link for that on January 12th on that case. So it's a big victory for free speech, and there's documents on here pertaining to the Supreme Court's ruling, NVA versus Mansky, and Rutherford Institute's amicus brief in the Minnesota Voters Alliance versus Joe Mansky. What's interesting about that too, on the whole free speech thing, is and what you can say is it has good intent. And I tell everybody this: even if you got people parading around, having you vote for a particular person, and so forth, you should start doing your own homework and think for yourself. That's always been the key. All right, don't let these other people tell you how to vote, how to wipe your rear end, etc. Do your own research. Have a routine, share information, and you can make it. Then you can make a conscious decision. And this is even guaranteed under the Minnesota Constitution, Article 1, titled Bill of Rights, and it says it in 2 and 16, all right, of that particular article. And I'll just read it here: Rights and Privileges, Article Section 2. No member of the state shall be disenfranchised or deprived of any rights or privileges secured to any citizen thereof, unless the law of the land or the judgment of his peers. There shall be neither slavery nor voluntary servitude in the state, otherwise than as punishment for a crime which a party has been convicted. So, first sentence is valid, and we can go down. We go further down, and. Of course, we can use ex post facto laws impairing contracts prohibited. Section 11, no bill attainer, ex post facto law or law impairing the obligation of contract shall be passed, and no conviction shall work corruption of blood or forfeiture of estate. You can add that to it as well. A freedom of conscience. Enumerating rights in this Constitution shall deny or impair others retained and inherit in the people. Okay, that's related to Article 9, of course, to talk about the place of worship. But I'll go a little bit further down here. But the liberty of conscience hereby secured shall not be construed as an excuse act of licentiousness or justified practice inconsistent with peace and safety of the state, nor shall money be drawn from the treasury for the benefit of any religious peace, societies, or religious theological seminaries. So the whole thing is separation of church and state. But the truth of the matter is, enumerated rights, natural law, Ninth Amendment, etc. So right there is on its face. So when you folks start reading that, that's why I tell people in all these states, people in their own states should look at their state constitution as well. Because one thing you have to see is when you make these arguments, everything's on its face, they can't really refute it. Instead of going to federal court all the time, you can just battle it within the states. Then, if necessary, hit those other channels. Because that's what the 10th Amendment's about, states' rights and all that good stuff. But right there, this particular law violates those sections of Article 1 under state constitution. So make that clear. And I'm going to add that to the memo as well, to my footnotes. And this one here came from Personal Liberty Flag Days and exercise in state worship. And this is by no other than Bob Livingston. Ned will remain the first reader until he learns his first lesson, that things that equal to the same are equal to each other. Same with the American people. You hear some music in the background. That's okay. Can you hear some music in the background? That's alright. So, I'll continue on here. Carefully chosen by words are the establishment of the basis of mass mind control lead to acceptance of all matter things that would seem appalling at the first glance. Words are created and repeated that expand the collective psyche to accept and repeat some more. People who are freely those terms are now in control of their own thinking process. Men by nature are followers. Therefore, with authority appears, they follow. When absolute authority emerges, the people will follow without question, including the point of self-sacrifice. Millions will give their own lives and their own and those of their sons and daughters in war and never question or consider what they are doing. Mystique government authority totally holds in its hands of life and death. Ours. Patriotism throughout history has covered multitude of mischief. U.S. establishment has confused cause and effect. And through flag waving mania in America, we are seeing it play out once again. Today is Flag Day. On June 14, 1777, Congressional Congress adopted a resolution designating the flag's design having 13 stripes alternating red and white, and 13 stars of white on a blue field. The new flag was first carried into battle on September 11th of that year in the Battle of Brandywine. First flag was recognized by Hartford, Connecticut in the summer of 1861. The timing is significant. It came just months after the southern states began seceding and formed the Confederacy in February. In 1916, President Woodrow Wilson issued a proclamation declaring June 14th as Flag Day. War was raging in Europe just 2 years before, and 2 weeks before Archduke Franz Friedenwald was assassinated. Wilson had delivered an address on June 14th, asking what the flag would stand for in the future. Wilson replied, "For just the use of undisputed national power for our self-possession, indeed for the assertion of the right of one nation to serve the other nations of the world." As president, he would assert rights of mankind, whatever the flag is unfurled. This is the philosophy of the U.S. government since, if not officially, then certainly unofficially. Rare are the days in the 20th century, and none exist in the 21st, in which the U.S. hasn't been engaged in wars in which the U.S. has exercised its undisputed national power against nations which have not attacked and which didn't possess the capability of attacking us. It wasn't until 1949 Congress passed and President Harry S. Truman signed into law an official Flag Day Declaration. likely the purpose for rallying the American people around his Cold War. With Russia and poking the eyes of the isolationist Republicans, war are not for patriotism and democracy, as we are propagandized. Wars are to kill for the mass profits of big business. And even General Smudley Butler talked about war as a racket. Phony patriotism is strong leverage against a population ignorant of the ways of treason by our own government. The U.S. is full of wars for democracy, killing millions under propaganda and patriotism with the majority support of the people and the full support of all but small cadre of elected representatives who are paid by the federal government, incidentally. In addition to the millions of foreign dead, these wars have left hundreds of thousands of American military members dead or maimed physically and or emotionally. The whole world knows about the U.S. military industrial complex war machine and its pursuit of profits, while Americans tend to turn a blind eye. Exactly. There's a decadent spirit controlling the perceptions of the American people, keeping them on the animal farm, controlling their perceptions long enough to impoverish and enslave them. In time and gradualism can change the system all the way from liberty to slavery, the animal farm. Over a few generations, without anyone being aware except a very few, those who ask questions. The flag is symbolic of a government that lies at every turn that enslaves its people, steals from their labor, passes laws that are an extraction to their Christian faith, takes from their liberty, mandates, funds the murder of 1 million babies a year, imports tens of thousands of immigrants to replace American workers. Ooh, I think I heard that. One moment. Yeah, I'll be back. Alright, the sound check's over. Hey, that's just part of the business. They all say here about it's like a symbolic of a government that lies at every truth, that enslaves us, people steal from the labor, passes law that are execration to their Christian faith, takes from their liberty, mandates and funds millions of murder of 1 million babies a year. Imports tens of thousands of immigrants to replace American workers and drive down wages, and that makes war on other countries. They have not threatened us. So you have to look at everything across the board, you know what I'm saying? The flag is symbolic of a constitutional slaughter on the altar of immortality and collectivism. It's symbolic of a freedom stolen long by a crony corporations and globalist banksters and unaccountable oligarchical robe Satanists and idol worshippers who usurp their authority, creating the laws out of thin air under the guise of interpreting the Constitution, a dictate not granted them under the original document. I love my nation, but I fear what my government has become and where it has taken us. If the flag represents that, why should anyone acknowledge its presence with more than a sneer? And he's, I can say this, he's making people think, and I admire that. And some people, like Betty says here, our flag represents our nation, and if you love our nation, you honor our flag that represents our nation. It's that simple. Rational said in this article doesn't even make sense. It's a twisting of facts to reflect twisted point of view. Honor your country. Our flag represents our country, and your votes orally conduct to help change the laws you believe may be unjust or unfair. Well, I'm not going to do a little argument here, but you have to look at things a lot bigger than making these comments. So if you want to go and say it's okay to attack these other countries and do these tyrannical laws, see, the fact is, it's unconstitutional. It does not supersede natural law. So I understand what Bob Livingston's talking about. You got a lot of folks out there that are symbolically desecrating our flag and what it really means. But people complain when players from the NFL kneel down during the national anthem. But when you got bobbleheads they want to vote in, does it, it's exceptional. So but Mr. Livingston is actually seeing things in a broader light. That's one thing you have to look at. Idol hero worship. Want true liberty and freedom. We should talk about what is in the Declaration of Independence and our Bill of Rights, which means government keep out. That's one of the areas you have to really seek, my friends. Look what's been going on. When people realize your tax dollars are going to these NFLs to pay homage to the military, which not trying to condemn, but I see a big exploitation. And there's some good people that serve. I'm not going to argue about that at all. But if you're trying to say imperialism's okay, so we should change it from to republic to empiric corporation or empire or corporation, wherever floats your boat, in their eyes. Because one thing I know for sure, we are considered a federal corporation under Title 28 U.S. Code Section 3002, Subsection 15. Look it up. And I find that unacceptable as well. So, one of the areas is how you do Flag Day. Do it honorably. And do it on principles. Be critical towards all forms of tyranny. Whether it's state, federal, or local. Demoniac resistance is a form of patriotism. A little rebellion now and then is good, stated by Thomas Jefferson. So, how did this nation start it? By mavericks, rebels. And when it, even with the Confederates, the 13 states seceded to start the Confederate States of America, which was considered a new country. There was it's called defiance. Oh, it's all about slavery. It's all about slavery. It's like, you folks better start going a little bit deeper. And I'm not saying. I read Jefferson Davis' farewell address. However, one of the things he said to the United States, we are not your enemy. So, folks got to start reading before jumping on some herd-conform bandwagon. And that's across the board. It doesn't matter what side of the paradigm you're on. And I have a flag. I have a couple. I use it out of homage, and I speak in truth to the best of my ability. And everyone could take the initiative on doing it. Why should 9/11 be considered Patriot Day? I call it Tyrannical Day, Treasonous Day. And if people still believe they attack us on September 11th because of our freedoms, we need a good smack upside the head out of love. Because you're being swindled. The Jim Jones syndrome is called. Alright. So I know it's been taking a little bit long than I thought, but that's okay. It's over an hour. Wow, I got a couple more here left. And this one here is very interesting. It's actually it's local related. It happened south from here on Miami-Dade County. It's a Florida Bulldog. And this one here is entitled Mayor's Campaign Pro for $14,000 donation to company sharing his law office. Oh, really? This is by Francisco Alvarado. And it says here, Miami Gardens Mayor Oliver Gilbert says his re-election campaign is under investigation for making a $14,000 donation to a company that shares office space with his private law practice. Another lawyer who's an elected servant. How sweet it is, right? In a recent email to Florida Bulldog reporter, Gilbert declined to answer questions, but the large expenditure his re-election campaign made a day before the August 30th, 2016 election. The campaign finance report shows the money was donated to Champion Learning, a tutoring, mentoring, and after-school service company, which has made Miami Lakes address as Gilbert's Eden Law Service of South Florida. Records filed by Gilbert's campaign identify Champion Learning as a nonprofit. State corporate records list is as for a profit entity. Wow, so it's like a flip-flop here, right? Mitt Romney syndrome. The campaign's August August 31st, 2016, finance report, the list for the purpose of the $14,000 as donations of the funds to a 501c3 firm. Gilbert cited the ongoing investigation as his reason for declining comment. He would not say which agency is handling the probe or if he has reinstated an attorney in the matter. I intend to fully cooperate with the investigation, he said. Hopefully others will cooperate with the investigation also. Kendra Bullock Major, Champions Learning President, also declined comment when reached by phone. I am not interested in answering any questions for an article, she said. Ethics Commission investigator. A former city official who requested anonymity said he was recently interviewed by an investigator from the Miami-Dade Commission on Ethics and Public Trust who is trying to determine if the $14,000 donation violated campaign finance law. There is something about it that doesn't smell right, the ex-official said. The ethics investigator also wants to take this to the state attorney in order to determine whether funds were ultimately deposited. Gilbert definitely has reason for concern. As his commission executive director John Senatorino said that he will not be unable to comment on the existence of any pending investigation. A criminal or ethics inquiry into Gilbert would mark for the second time in the 10 months that a politician, Miami-Dade's third largest city, is in the crosshairs of corruption watchdogs. Last August, the Miami Herald reported that the Miami-Dade State Attorney's Office opened an investigation into how Miami Gardens Vice Mayor Ejaro Rado paid for two trips to Africa that he claimed that were for city business. The Florida Bulldog has reported that the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission is conducting a broader investigation to allegations that proceeds. One moment. All right, sorry about that. Our train was coming by. And, of course, it says here, the Bulldog has reported that U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission also conducted a broad investigation to allegations the city has mispanned proceeds from a $60 million general obligation bond issue, including using those monies over expenses for the mayor, vice mayor, and five other city council members. Mayor Gilbert's Eden Law Service of South Florida and Champion Learning here share Suite 102 in a drab four-story building at 6175 North 153rd Street in Miami Lakes. Wait a minute. The campaign office is in Miami Lakes. How come it's not in Miami Gardens, right? No signs announced the presence of either Eden Loft or Champion, and no one present when a reporter was recently visited. Bullock Major also listed it in the same address in 2013 as treasurer for a defunct for-profit corporation called Citizens for Progress and Accountability. Is President Sandra Pierre Paul, Gilbert's former executive secretary, who is now an information officer for the Miami Gardens Parks and Recreation Department. That sounds like birds of a feather flock together, right? While Champion Learning is for a for-profit company, the Florida Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services records identify it as a fictitious name for Sisters for Abundant Living Ministries, a federally tax-exempt 501c3 organization that also operates out of the Miami Lakes office. State records, however, shows that fictitious name registration expired 5 years ago. Ooh, fumble, could we say, right? The charity changed its name to Sisters for Abundant Living, Inc. in June 2016. On its website, Champions Learning is able to accept donations on behalf of Sisters for Abundant Living Ministries. Kinley Tutton, an Agricultural Department spokesperson, said Florida law allows for-profit organizations to solicit funds for a nonprofit arm as long as those funds are then used for nonprofit. The federal income tax records show that Sister was established in 2015. Its president is Verdina T. Bullock, who was in 2016 was paid $10,000. Kendra Bullock Major, India's daughter, was listed as Sister's executive director and earned $73,000. Sister's reported total revenue that a year of nearly $1.1 million and expenses of $892,000. The charity received 1,064 $1.064 million in government funds. The principal source identified only as unspecified state grant to help with the outreach program of the youth and adults in Broward and Dade counties. Right? Hey. The sister's most recent state registration application says it used that money to hold seminars and provide health services, educational services, mentoring and counseling of women and disadvantaged youth. Gardena Bullock could not reach for comment. The Gilberts campaign itemized $14,000 expenditure to champion learning appears problematic for other reasons too. Election law violated? According to Roger Austin, a University of Florida political science expert on campaign finance, Gilbert's re-election campaign may have violated Florida law governing how to use surplus campaign funds because the gift was made before Election Day. He does not appear to have followed the law, Austin said. The fact he spent the money before Election Day is troubling because any money spent on Election Day should be getting for votes. I'm not sure that expense would generate votes. The mayor re-election campaign may also have to explain why Champion Learning was identified as a nonprofit entity when it's not. I'm sorry, I find this hilarious. Oh yeah, all you folks are a bunch of illiterates. We know more than you. It's allegedly right now. I just sometimes I just scratch my head. Florida law doesn't allow giving surplus funds to for-profit companies. Austin said, although many organizations and entities have complex structures that allow them to sort of route money whether they want, and this one could have for-profit division, a non-profit division, and a charitable division. $14,000 donation warrants further increase, Austin said. Having done this for many years as a lawyer, campaign finance consultant, and someone who wrote his dissertation on campaign finance reform, this looks and smells like there is something shady going on. He said it is definitely worth checking into. And there's other stuff in here, too, you can look at as well. It's very interesting because it really scratches the mind, I would say, because it's been going on for such a long time, and these folks believe they can keep going and going and going. However, these are allegations, so I'm not going to jump the gun on this. The whole thing, the truth of the matter is, how deep does the rabbit hole go? One of the areas, if it becomes official, that is totally illegal, someone's going to be paying the price, especially this new mayor. And the folks, what the people can do in the city of Miami Gardens is do a recall vote as well on this individual. But, hey, man. Sometimes I just laugh when you have all these lawyers in office, they all believe the constituents are just completely dumbasses. But when you go in there and call them out and use their language, they go crazy. I know that for a fact. All right, so let me probably do one more here in a moment. And this one came from LouRockwell.com. And this is mostly from Andrew P. Napolitano, who is the judge. And he's good at what he does. I have to give him credit. He's not in this left-right paradigm, just, you know, right from wrong. So, it's here. More assault on the rule of law. And as it reads here, amid an all happy hoopla over President Donald Trump trip to Singapore, where he began a process for what he hoped would be the normalization of relations between the United States and North Korea and the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, has come an effort by the House Intelligence Committee to interfere with the criminal investigation of the president. The committee's chairman, David Nunes, a Republican from California and a Republican majority on the committee, has demanded that the Department of Justice turn over documents pertaining to the origins of the investigation of President Trump by Special Counsel Mueller. And Nunes has threatened Mueller's superior, Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein, with censure, contempt, and impeachment if he fails to comply. Can Congress interfere in an ongoing federal investigation? Can it get its eyes on law enforcement activity, active files? In a word, no. Here's the backstory. In the pre-9/11 era, when the FBI and the DOJ devoted they were primarily to investigate the criminal activity. They both answered not only to the president, but also the House and Senate Judiciary Committees. The long-standing relationship came about by the way of a check on the exercise of prosecutorial power by the DOJ and the FBI. These congressional committees approved the budget for law enforcement. The argument went as watchdogs, so to speak, they are entitled to know how the taxpayers' money and money borrowed in the taxpayers' name is being spent. The relationship between the congressional committees on one hand and the federal law enforcement on the other has been a give and take. Push me, pull your relationship that generally led to compromise between Congress and law enforcement. After 9/11, Congress passed the Patriot Act, in addition to authorizing FBI agents to write their own search warrants for all sorts of custodians of records, legal, medical, postal, and banking enterprises, supermarkets, and libraries, to name a few, gave the FBI domestic intelligence mission, not unlike the threat of National Security Agency, which is America's domestic spying apparatus. The intelligence mission enabled to the FBI to utilize new tools for law enforcement under the guise of the intelligence gathering, stated differently, by pretending to be looking for spies, the FBI found crooks. Because the legal threshold for spying for intelligence purpose is far lower than the legal threshold for obtaining a traditional search warrant, FBI agents often took the easier route. But the FBI's spying mission also subjected to the scrutiny of two additional congressional committees, on the one House and one in the Senate. The cross-pollination of law enforcement and intelligence gathering, the mixture of two distinct roles, one traditional for the FBI and the other novel to one clearly regulated by the Constitution and other purporting to be outside of it, tempted not only FBI agents to use tools of spycraft for law enforcement, even though it's prohibited by the Fourth Amendment, but also Congress. Now back to Representative Nunes and the House Intelligence Committee. Republicans of that committee are determined to use their regulatory powers over federal agencies gathering to investigate federal law enforcement. They are doing this because they claim to smell a rat in the origins of the special counsel. Okay. Mueller to determine whether there was a sufficient probable cause to commence the criminal investigation of Trump back in 2016. But it is not a role of Congress to do this in the midst of a criminal investigation, and it is not a role of the Congressional Intelligence Committee to scrutinize law enforcement. There are two dangers to the rule of law here. The first, that the members of this committee could use their security clearances to examine classified materials and then use what they have seen for political narrative. They cannot lawfully accept the floor of Congress publicly reveal classified documents, what they have seen, what they can, and they have done so in the past, summarize them publicly and with a political spin. That endangers the sources of criminal investigation, many of whom people who communicate with investigators and a great personal risk and to whom confidentially has been promised. The confidentiality is recognized in the law as the informant's privilege, and it keeps the confidential criminal matter from public and peering congressional eyes until the investigation is concluded. The second and equally far harmful danger is that members of the committee could leak what they have seen. To prevent this, prosecutors have a privilege to keep their files secret until they charge or exonerate their targets or subjects. Under the Constitution, we enjoy separation of powers. Congress writes the laws, the executive branch enforces them, and the courts interpret them. Congress can no more constitutionally interfere with ongoing law enforcement for political purposes than the DOJ can interfere with the passage of congressional legislation that doesn't like. The down and dirty fear the DOJ and the FBI have is that revealing the contents of the criminal file on the president to his political allies in Congress in the midst of an investigation of him would be a dangerous precedent. One that would pollute the investigation and give present and future politically powerful potential defendants the advantages that no one has no one else has. The desperate treatment of the president as a defendant strikes at the heart of the rule of law. And the rule of law is what protects us from politicians who can't restrain themselves and violate their oath to uphold the Constitution. So they have to wait and see. They can't just demand. And I know a lot of the Trump supporters out there get angry about it, but that is what the rule of law is about. And I'm not a big fan of the Patriot Act anyway. It's illegal, null and void, and that's why the states can say stick it to the federal government. But one thing for sure, you cannot demand if an investigation is happening. And I'm very convinced, okay, that this whole thing is nothing more than a charade, a facade.
Absolutely.
They're trying to blame the whole Russian collusion on the election. As far as I'm concerned, it was a total joke from the very beginning. If you study geopolitics, even on the federal level, all the garbage and sloppiness they've been pursuing, and assume that the American people are just a bunch of damn illiterates, you realize they're nothing more than a full of crap. So, they cannot interfere. They have to lay it out on the table. Then they can make a decision. That's it. None of this demand, contempt, and all that is null and void. So we got the separation of powers, balance of powers, and all that in our Constitution. And that is it. Oh, yeah. I thank everyone for listening. Plus, feel free to download and share us on your social media networks. If you have any questions, comments, or you want to say something that's interesting, then want to check out whatever you do. Please address your correspondence in the forum. Hit me on Facebook, Twitter, Google+, Breaker, iHeartRadio, Tumblr, YouTube, Dreams Network. Please donate money to these guys because they may be shutting down. Minds.com, FutureNet.club, Patreon.com/local33eyes, Gab, GAB.AI, Yours.org, which is YOURS.org, OneWay.org, One Way, all together, or Buddy List, which is buddylist.co. Pretty cool stuff. You should check it out. Support these social media networks. In addition, you can email me at lokiluck3@gmail.com or to your encrypted one, especially with the Proton Mail account, lokiluck03@protonmail.com. Well, that's all for now, folks. And I know it went a little bit over an hour. It happens, but I enjoy what I do. So, if you want to be a patron, hit me with a little love, and I'll appreciate it. All right, my friends. Once again, thank you for your time. But always remember that the maniac resistance is helping the soul and can liberate humanity. Until next time, take care of yourselves, keep on spreading love, and may your guardian spirits be with you.